Mes pradėsime diskusijų.
So we'll start the discussion part. There will be two of them, and the part one is what's next for Europe, transatlantic turbulence, Brexit and China. I will invite the speakers, and soon I will switch to English. Everyone who needs translation from English, if you still need the headsets, feel free to take them at the entrance, but the discussion will be in English.
Of the first panel, what's next for Europe, transatlantic turbulence, Brexit and China? And the first speaker is General Robert Spalding, who is a senior fellow at Hudson Institute, as well as just recently been at the National Security Council of Donald Trump's administration and was one of the authors of the National Security Strategy of the United States. General, please. Thank you. Yeah, the first. I would also like to introduce Margarita Šešelgytė, who is director of Vilnius University Institute of International Relations and Political Science. And last but not least, James Rogers, who is director of Global Britain Program at the Henry Jackson Society in London, the United Kingdom. So before we begin, I would like to make a technical note. All of you can ask questions during our conversation. You all have small pieces of paper on how to do it online. So you can access the link by typing it in your mobile phones or laptops, or by simply following the QR code. So please go there, and you can always ask a question. At the second part of our discussion, I will read some of the most popular questions, the best questions to the speakers. You'll also have an opportunity to ask questions by microphone, but we encourage you to use the internet platform as well. So now we'll begin the panel discussion. I'll ask each of the speakers to make some introductory statements on three different topics. So starting with General Spalding, you're obviously a great expert of China. You had some opportunities to live in the country, you've learned the language, and you also know how China is being perceived at the moment in the United States from the very top level of politics as well as from senior positions at the State Department and Department of Defense. So can you just give us an outlook? What are the major trends of today's Sino-American relationship, and what are the implications for the U.S. allies all around the globe?
Well, I think that was a great presentation we just heard, talking about the promise of the end of the Cold War, and I would say that more than any nation, the Chinese and the Chinese Communist Party has benefited from the end of the Cold War and the advance of globalization, the internet. And rather than, accepting the open arms of the free world in trying to bring them into an order that promoted democratic principles, rule of law, human rights, civil liberties, and instead they've tried to essentially suppress those, not only within their own country, but also abroad, using the openness of global trade, of global finance, of really the connectedness of the world and the internet to essentially export the principles that they articulate so clearly in document number 9, which was essentially leaked out of the Communist Party and translated. And really what I, a document that I describe as the anti-Bill of Rights, and really describes a world that is beginning to take shape. In organizations like the United Nations and the WTO, which essentially is counter to the principles of free trade, of democracy, of human rights, of civil liberties, and using the tools of the West, both the technology, the talent, the innovation and the capital, but also the relationships, the open trade and financial relationships to export those visions for a new future. A future, quite frankly, that today sees over a million people in concentration camps once again, and certainly, as was recently talked about at the UK tribunal, the forced organ harvesting of prisoners of conscience. So it's truly a tragedy that we find ourselves in a what I call a bipolar. The free world is confronted with totalitarianism once again, and we have to join together to fight it. But it's a different fight. It's not a military fight. It's an economic fight. It's an informational fight, and it requires that we think differently about how we defend our democracies in a globalized, internet-connected world.
Just a quick follow-up question. How do you evaluate the policies of this administration in the U.S., Donald Trump's administration? Obviously, you were a part of it in 2017 and 2018. So what's been done, and can we expect that the same trends will continue the next year, in spite of who wins the elections, either Donald Trump or some candidate from the Democratic Party?
I think so. First of all, particularly if you listen to Secretary Pompeo and the State Department, there's been a re-emphasis on principles, on values, on democratic principles, on human rights, and I think that will continue. It was clear in our national security strategy that we had essentially adopted this foreign policy that openness would lead to democracy, and that we needed to more closely align with democracies in order to promote the kind of principles that going forward. So I think that's clear. In terms of how you approach these challenges today, That is in works. It's been 3 years now that we have been essentially beginning to change the bureaucracy within the United States to focus on globalization. The internet is a challenge, but there's still a lot of work to do. I would say the third part that still needs to be done, and really is going to only, I think, be successful when we link arms with democracies, is investing in our economies once again, investing in our societies, investing in our people. And I think, I'm hopeful that trend will continue. It is strengthening, it's deepening, it's becoming enmeshed in the bureaucracy, but it's also becoming enmeshed in the political, both in the right and the left in the United States. So this realization that we have to think differently about national security, I think will continue, and I think you will see only acceleration from here.
Thank you. Margarita, we've heard the president speaking on some challenges and some opportunities of Lithuanian foreign policy today and tomorrow. Which trends do you think are the most important for us, and how we should react to the changing circumstances in many parts of the world? It's not only China. We see some internal difficulties in Europe. We see some disturbing patterns in NATO as well. Is that a growing challenge, or is it something that we should expect?
Okay. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, Linas, thank you for this opportunity to speak here in front of this distinguished audience and to be here on this particular occasion. And I'll start from the major challenge. How do we see it here in Lithuania? We talk a lot about the challenge of transatlantic relations. And there are two types of discussions going on. One of the discussions leads to doomsday scenario, saying that we have so many disagreements, we have so many clashes of interest, which have been visible during the several last years. There are some, disagreements on trade, on the issues of international politics. We differently see how the climate change issues should be addressed. There are disagreements on the ground as well. We've seen what happened in Syria and how Europeans were not happy that the U.S. didn't coordinate their actions with them. And this opinion leads to the doomsday scenario, saying that, transatlantic relations are getting worse and worse, and that's why we are doomed. But there is another opinion. There is another discussion going on, saying that, there were always disagreements between the U.S. and European partners, among the European partners, but these are just minor disagreements, because there are some things that we do share. And what do we share? We share common values, Western values, and that's the most important thing. And these values are endangered today due to the new security challenges, terrorism, radicalism, rising powers who do not share necessarily the same values with us. So the importance of those values is not decreasing, but rather increasing, I would say. And I remember yesterday we had a discussion with my students about the power, the essence of power in international politics. And we were trying to define what power is. And I asked them to define the elements of soft power. What does soft power mean for them? And one of the students said, you know, I define soft power that the country that has strong soft power is the country where I want to live. And Europe and United States of America and Canada, the Western world, are the countries where people want to live. But the problem is that we did not do a lot, probably in Europe, did not do enough to protect our way of life, Western way of life. And this Western way of life could be endangered. And I see this challenge and the disagreement between the US and Europeans about protecting our way of life, probably not spending enough on protection of our way of life, not as a problem, but as a window of opportunity. We have new commission, we have new parliament, we have new cycle in Europe. And I see this new cycle with a certain degree of optimism, because what I hear new president of the commission saying that EU should be more active globally, that soft power is not enough, hard power is also needed, and that we have to take care about it. New high representative for foreign policy, Mr. Borrell, says that he is interested in more effective foreign policy. He said that European Union foreign policy has been for a long time as a valley of tears, very strong on emotions, condolences, and concerns. And what he looks for is effectiveness. So I have optimism about that, not only because of new look, new words, but also new deeds, what has been done so far. For the first time in the history of the European Union, European security and defense have been supported by the funds. Multiannual financial framework foresees 11 billion euros going to defense for the European Defense Fund, who would be an opportunity to develop new capabilities, also to invest more in research and development within the area of defense. Connecting Europe, 5.7 billion euros. It's very interesting, could be allusion to NATO, that in the new multi-annual financial framework, 2% of the budget is dedicated for security and defense. So European Union is doing something, developing capabilities, also thinking about the financing, strategic autonomy. On one hand, I see this as a window of opportunity to strengthen the capabilities, but on the other hand, I see it as a potential of certain risks emerging. And these risks are related to the different threat perceptions that exist in European Union. And I think that that would be one of the greatest challenge in the forthcoming years, to be able to agree on the strategic direction and to be able to reconcile different threats. Because when you say strategic autonomy, it's a good thing to be autonomous, to take strategic decisions and to make strategic actions. But then there is a question, for what? What for we need the strategic autonomy? And what for we are capable to ensure strategic autonomy, either to fight the terrorists or to withstand powers like Russia? And until we have this agreement between the southern countries and the eastern countries of Europe, I think that we will have some challenges. But as in words of Stasys Lozoraitis, that he believes in the future, a happy future of Lithuania, I do believe in the happy future of Europe, because I think that in all, we love our life, we love our values, and in order to have our way of life, to have our way of life sustainable, for us it is very important to have strong transatlantic link. And in order to have transatlantic link, strong transatlantic link, we need strong Europe.
Thank you. Just to follow up, do you think it's in Lithuania's interest to have stronger common European foreign and defense policy? Because usually Lithuania was quite reluctant or at least skeptical on these kind of initiatives, simply stating that it could be a duplication of NATO on a defense side, and on a foreign policy side, we probably do not trust some of our Western partners enough in order to have a real foreign minister, for instance, of European Union, who could represent also Lithuania's opinion on, say, Belarus or Ukraine. So, and it doesn't seem to be changing, and we are not participating in some of the initiatives, such as the French one, to have certain
groups outside the European Union.
Yes. So do you think it's in Lithuania's interest, basically, to move towards a deeper integration of these policy areas?
Yes, I think it should be the interest of every small member state within the European Union. The more we are integrated, the stronger we are. The only challenge is that for a number of years, European Union was talking a lot and investing a lot in the creation of the institutions, but not investing in the capabilities. So that's one of the concerns that we have here in Lithuania. Another concern is related to the threat assessment that I've talked, that when some of the European Union countries say that Russia is a partner or could be is a potential partner, that makes us anxious, because for us it's not a partner, it's a threat. So I think that at some point more discussions should be happening on the European Union about the threat assessment, because that's going to be one of the major challenges.
Thank you. James, well, tomorrow is an important day in the United Kingdom. You have a parliamentary elections, which could be a big step forward in order to finally solve the puzzle of the Brexit, whatever that means. So could you basically try to explain today's politics in the United Kingdom and maybe the nearest future perspective? Because even if the United Kingdom, and that seems to be the most likely scenario still, leaves the EU quite soon, whether it's going to stay engaged in European matters, and in what way, what platforms could be used? Because usually the United Kingdom is perceived as one of the closest allies of Lithuania on many issues, especially on geopolitics, but also on Eastern Partnership issues as well.
Yes, well, thank you, Linus, for inviting me, and thank you for coming to listen. It's very good to be back in the Baltic region after a few years. I've worked for many years at the Baltic Defence College in Estonia, so I think I've got some idea of how important the relationship is between the UK and the Baltic states, a relationship which I hope will continue to flourish and prosper irrespective of what's going to happen tomorrow. I think tomorrow we're likely to see what will become or what is the most important election in maybe more than a generation, because it will potentially define the type of relationship that Britain has with Europe, both the European Union and NATO, in the years to come. Now, you might ask what is actually going on in Britain. And what I think is happening, and what is the backdrop to this, is the breakdown of the established consensus that has been developed over the last 40 years. That's to say, the framework of neoliberalism, which has become prominent in both the Conservative Party and the Labour Party. And I think the financial crisis and the Great Recession in the late 2000s fundamentally challenged the dominant assumptions that underpinned much of the political philosophy in my country. I know the same, challenges have been drawn out in many other countries, including the United States. But what's so interesting about this election is, in many respects, the kind of consensus in the centre, which dominated both parties, the Labour Party under Tony Blair and the Conservative Party under David Cameron, has broken down. And the parties have moved further towards not necessarily the fringes of the left and right, but they've certainly become more left and right. The Labour Party has moved towards the left, and the Conservative Party, in many respects, has moved towards the right. Now, if you look at the general election that is coming up tomorrow, and you look at the opinion poll data, it shows that the Conservatives are likely to win a majority. Not necessarily a very large majority, but still nonetheless a majority. So the opinion polls, the most accurate one was released last night. It interviews over 100,000 different people and goes for a number of different formula to produce a result. And it was the most accurate one in terms of both the 2017 general election and I think also the US general election in 2016. And it's predicting that around 43% of the population is going to vote for the Conservative Party, 34% for the Labour Party, 12% for the Liberal Democrats, 3% for the Scottish Nationalist Party, and then around 10% for all the other parties, which are all minority parties and will gain literally a handful of MPs between them. Because our system, based on proportional representation, based on first past the post...
I thought you changed it already.
Yes. will amplify the larger vote. So the Conservatives are likely to win, at least according to the poll that was undertaken yesterday, 339 seats. The Labour Party, 231. The Scottish Nationalists will get 41. The Liberal Democrats, 15. And the other parties, around 5 to 6 between them. So you need, in my country, 326 seats to form a majority. So it seems quite likely that the Conservatives, based on this projection or this poll, will win a majority. However, it is within the bounds of possibility that there could be still another hung parliament. And that opens up all sorts of interesting possibilities. The first one would be that the Conservatives, if they do not get an outright majority but lack a few parliamentarians to form a majority, might seek some kind of agreement with one of the parties in Northern Ireland, which they did in 2017. However, the party, the DUP, that they formed an arrangement with in the previous election is not very happy with them because of the negotiations in terms of Brexit. They're unhappy with the renegotiated settlement that Boris Johnson has secured. So if they are able to form some kind of agreement, this might open up another period of volatility where the UK government seeks to renegotiate the already renegotiated settlement, and that could be, of course, problematic. The other opportunity or the other possibility would be that the Labour Party would get a far larger minority than it is currently projected to or is likely to achieve, and it would form some kind of coalition with one of the other parties, for example, the Scottish Nationalist Party. And that could open up all sorts of interesting possibilities, because this is where it gets much more interesting, because those two parties have a very different understanding, I would say, to Britain's role in NATO and Britain's role in relation to the European Union. So the Conservative Party is still very committed to Britain's role in NATO and indeed has increased defence funding over the last couple of years, with a significant increase this last year, and wishes to, I think, make up for the fact that it is withdrawing from the EU by compensating by doing more in the context of NATO and the broader defence of Europe. However, the Labour Party, it is not clear to what extent they will remain wedded to NATO in the same way that the UK has for the past 70 years, because their leader, Jeremy Corbyn, has openly questioned the alliance and whether it should remain. He has openly questioned the need for a nuclear capability by the UK, and in fact, he has said that he cannot see any eventuality whereby he would want to use that nuclear deterrent, even if the direct interests of the UK or its allies were threatened. And he has also stated, in fact, 2 weeks ago, that he could not foresee many eventualities where he would provide military support to a NATO ally in the event of an Article 5 contingency. He would prefer to provide political support, diplomatic support, and so on and so forth. Now, with the Scottish Nationalist Party, they are very hostile to the continuation of Scotland in the UK, and they would want a referendum in order to leave. And they are also very hostile to the maintenance of nuclear weapons by the UK. And they would want Britain to remove the nuclear base that is near Glasgow and relinquish nuclear weapons or move them to England or somewhere else in the UK. So a coalition between those parties could actually lead, I think, to quite a profound change in Britain's orientation towards NATO and Britain's commitment to the defence of Europe through upholding a nuclear deterrent and the broader conventional capability. All three parties are committed to spending 2% of GDP on defence, and all three parties are committed, at least the parties, are committed to the upholding of a nuclear deterrent by the UK, although, as I said, the Scottish Jeremy Corbyn, sorry, the leader of the Labour Party, does not like the idea of using such weapons. So in effect, he has disarmed the UK through that fact. Should he become leader? Now, the Liberal Democrats, the other major party in the UK, which is not likely to get a very large vote share, but nevertheless will get something, is committed to upholding the 2% of GDP on defence. It's also committed to upholding the nuclear weapons system, but it's committed also to reducing the capability, to move away from a continuous at-sea capability and to try and find something else which will cost a lot less money, but provides the UK with some kind of residual capability in terms of a nuclear deterrent in the final instance that one should be required. So I think, to sort of cut this all down, that it is still quite likely, based on all the opinion polls that have been undertaken to date, that the Conservative Party will win a majority. It will probably be a smaller majority than many initially hoped to provide stability, but nevertheless, there will probably still be a majority. And all I would say at this juncture in time is that insofar as we seem to be moving into a period of more of a greater or a more competitive international environment, the UK describes this in its National Strategic Review as wider state competition or intense interstate competition, I would say that it's better that we have this discussion among ourselves now and hopefully come to a resolution, one that continues to uphold the defence of Europe through NATO, than to do so in maybe 5 or 10 years when the environment may be more volatile still. Because from my perspective, the UK's support and its power are needed in the context of NATO and the broader Western alliance in the years ahead to ensure that the democratic way of life that we've come to enjoy and the liberal values that we have constructed and spread continue to remain, or at least continue to be upheld not only here but also around the world. So I would say we need to keep our eyes focused on the UK for at least a couple more days, and hopefully we will have some form of resolution.
Thank you very much. I'll use my questions for the follow-up from the audience because I would like to make it as interactive as possible. So there are two probably questions. The first one is a bit related to what you talked. What would you think will be the Conservative government's policy on Russia if it's elected and if your polls are correct? And the second one, do you think that the Labour leader Corbyn would resign if the party fails to form a government after this election, and who could replace him? And there's one name being mentioned in the question, McDonnell. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I think the Conservative Party's approach towards Russia will remain very similar to the existing Conservative Party's or the previous Conservative Party's relationship with Russia. Russia is seen as a strategic challenge to British interests and the interests of the broader Euro-Atlantic security system. After all, Russia has actually used chemical weapons on UK soil. There are deep antagonisms between aspects of the British political and economic elite and Russia. The UK dislikes the kind of political system that has existed in Russia. And of course, there is a long-running geopolitical confrontation between the UK and Russia that goes all the way back into the 19th century in terms of the great game between Britain and Russia in Afghanistan and the broader Eurasian region. So I don't foresee any changes there. Now, if you look over the last few weeks and the last few months, there has been, I think, even a stepping up of the understanding of the kind of challenge that Russia poses to the UK and to the broader West. So if you look at the Chief of the Defence Staff's lecture, his annual lecture on defence, last week, he outlined quite vividly the kind of strategic relation, the kind of strategic competition that we're beginning to see between China, Russia, and other countries in the West. In this case, the UK, of course, also the US. And he basically argued that we need to turn Clausewitz on his head in terms of the idea that war is the continuation of policy with the addition of other means. And in fact, we need to start looking at the other way around. So in a way, we're already involved in a war, but we're just using it through, we're just executing it through other means. That's to say political means, geopolitical means, all sorts of means, economic, diplomatic, it doesn't really matter. The fact, however, is that we are involved in this long, deep competition that's not going to end anytime soon. So I think this idea is actually beginning to spread and capture many within the British political establishment, particularly among the Conservative Party and the broader strategic elites. In terms of the Labour Party, that is an open question. The Labour Party and Jeremy Corbyn are not necessarily the same thing. I would say that Jeremy Corbyn has, in some ways, not hijacked the Labour Party, but his vision of what the Labour Party should be has certainly been pushed very actively within the Labour Party. So the Labour Party today is very different from the Labour Party of Tony Blair. And that's simply because various MPs have changed, a certain group of MPs or a certain vision of what the Labour Party should be has gained momentum. And that is, in fact, the group that has come to dominate what the Labour Party actually is. Now, Jeremy Corbyn is, I would say, quite actively a kind of a pacifist. He does not think that there is any role for military power or economic power to be used or even diplomatic power in an active way. He sees the role of the UK and of the Labour Party within the UK, should it come to power and gain a position within government, to try and just dampen competitions and confrontations around the world. So he sees things in a different way. So we might see him trying to reach out to the various regimes that exist around the world, whether that is in Moscow or in Beijing or in Tehran or in Venezuela or wherever. I think that it will be a very different type of approach. Now, in terms of whether or not he continues to hold power, should he lose the election, well, that's an interesting question, and I simply don't know the answer. It is very clear that he has become deeply embedded in the Labour Party because of the role that the constituencies within the Labour Party have played in actually getting him there and holding him there. But if he loses the election, that's going to be quite a big sort of come down for him, particularly after the Conservative Party has governed for 9 years, and especially after the last 3 years of discord due to the attempts to withdraw the UK from the EU. So it should be easy for him to actually prevail in some respects. But the opinion polls are suggesting that he won't. So therefore, it is quite likely that there could be an internal sort of putsch within the Labour Party to get rid of him and replace him with someone else. The Shadow Chancellor might be the successor.
Thank you. So we have plenty of questions, and I'll try to group them a bit. And then, even though some of these are addressed directly to one of the speakers, to ask all of you to respond. So the first group of questions are related to China. So one that I would like to read out is, how does Xi Jinping's China view Putin's Russia as an ally, vassal, or question mark? Does Chinese dream include the Russian Far East? And it's a question posed by Konstantin Eggert from Deutsche Welle. So basically, China and Russia, could that be an alliance against the West, or maybe China views Russia as a weaker partner, and that probably explains why Russia sometimes is reluctant to be open for Chinese investments in some sectors, as many other countries are as well. The second aspect on China is obviously related to technology. We see a lot of countries now saying that Chinese investment in technology, in 5G or other networks, is a challenging perspective. But on the other hand, even though, for instance, the recent European Commission paper stated that China could be a strategic rival or a rival or a competitor, a lot of countries, including the UK, to some extent Lithuania and others, have Chinese technologies already embedded in their systems. So basically, how realistic is a discussion whether we can have Chinese inside of our networks or outside of them, depending on realities on the ground? So maybe that's a question for all of you. Touch upon the aspects that you think you're more capable of speaking of. Maybe general, you could be the first one.
So I think the challenge of Russia and the challenge of China actually are linked. Clearly, Russia and China have a strong economic, if not ideological, relationship. And I think as both nations become more integrated into the global world, the ability to have innovation, technology, talent, and capital flow from the West to China really promotes and strengthens their bonds, particularly as both countries essentially aspire for principles that lie outside where the international order really wants to be. And so there is a natural attractiveness between them because of this fact that they both have very authoritarian regimes, and both are kind of antagonistic to the principles of democracy and human rights and civil liberties and rule of law. That being said, you know, we create the challenge, we increase the challenge the more integrated we allow them to be in our economies, in our societies, and certainly in our technological fabric as we're connected with the internet. And so it is a choice. It is a choice of what kind of world do we want to live in? Do we want to live in a world of democracy and human rights and civil liberties and rule of law? Or do we want the lure of Chinese money? And if we do, then we create challenges from ourselves, not just from a China perspective, but also from a Russia perspective, because those benefits that flow into China are accrued by the Russians as well. So it is a fact that we are pushing them together, but at the same time we are strengthening them together. And so we need to determine how to move forward, whether or not we want to have them so integrated into the world order, or do we need to more carefully circumscribe our relationships with both of them.
Yeah, maybe a bit on technology part, the 5G.
Well, that's the real question. Do we want to have essentially the capacity for the Chinese to have access to our data that they can use via machine learning and artificial intelligence to grow the power of their tech companies to then use for influence and intelligence purposes to strengthen their liberal society? Or do we want to promote democracy in our own countries? If we do, then it is a clear choice. And so we in the United States spend $800 billion on defense per year. It is really a question for all democracies everywhere: how important is protecting your citizens' data to protecting your way of life? And I think what we find with particularly the recent study by ASPI, Australian Strategic Policy Institute, Samantha Hoffman's paper on engineering global consent, that the aggregation of data today is equivalent to the aggregation of power. And we see this in the large tech companies, but we also see it in totalitarian regimes like the Chinese Communist Party-led China. So we have to think about the implications of that. And so we do spend on defense, a lot on defense. We're talking about spending 2% on European defense, but then we think of our telecommunications networks as something that lies outside of the realm of national security. Clearly, with the influence in our political systems in the United States and elsewhere, using these as a conduit to do that, we need to think differently about that.
Just a very short remark on that. Could that be the most important factor determining how Washington D.C. views its allies? I mean, the policies of allies on China could be the most important factor on how the U.S. views its allies.
To the extent that we have military relationships, that will be the key component, I think, of the military relationship going forward, because, of course, it affects the ability for forces to interoperate.
Margarita?
Well, I can look at this question from the Lithuanian perspective, probably. James said, we are facing increased global competition, and Lithuania is a part of this competition, either we want it or not. We are a small state with a small capability, so our ability to withstand this global competition on our own is pretty limited. So our goal is try to respond to this challenge through the international institutions that we are part of, European Union, NATO, while trying to cooperate with our allies. The problem is that what China is trying to do, it tries to use the same politics as Russia, divide et impera, tries to approach various countries or groups of the countries and offer something to those countries and ask something in return. So we have to be very reasonable not to get into this trap and be quite resilient. Another problem is interference operations. For the first time, I guess, in our recent history, we've seen that on our streets this year when the Chinese embassy has been involved in the demonstration which was reacting to our support demonstration to Hong Kong. So we do not have this much, but that's coming, and we need to understand the potential challenges and how to react. Also, another potential challenge that I see for Lithuania is that China is also influencing European policy on Russia. Russia is seen as a kind of a swing state. And the big countries within the European Union want to persuade Russia to stay within Europe, to stay with Europe and not to go with China. And this politics could be pretty challenging for us in the Baltics. So we have to be very well attentive to what's happening.
Just a follow-up question. Let's imagine a company or even a government that looks at China from a bit of a different perspective. Investments in Europe are quite stagnating, and the economy is not growing as fast as it has been growing in the 60s or 70s. We see that there are not enough alternatives to get investments from the United States or some other countries, while Chinese offer a lot of new opportunities. Also, Huawei and other companies, Chinese companies, usually offer services on a much cheaper price than the competitive offers from the European companies, for instance. Well, how do you combine those two things, the need for investments and a cooperation which could be beneficial for both sides without posing any national security issues, and those national security aspects that you've mentioned?
Well, this challenge is a huge challenge, and I think that here in Lithuania, at some point, we are even more resilient than some of the other countries in the West, because we know what investments and economy that in authoritarian countries, investments and economy is very much tied to the politics, and we managed to develop this resilient view vis-a-vis Russian investment, and we view, economic cooperation with Russia through certain lenses of, caution, anxiety, while trying to not to be too open and realizing the potential risks. So I think that we here have it, and that might help us also to be more resilient vis-a-vis the potential challenges while cooperating with China. But in cooperation with China, as I already mentioned, as a small country, our hands in many, many cases are tied. So for us, the best strategies go through the European formats. And at this point, I think it's very important that European Union is putting an emphasis that China is not a partner, but strategic rival. And we'll see EU-China strategy. I think that there will be more emphasis on this potential competition, and especially on technologies, how the European Union as a bloc should view Chinese investments and the cooperation with China. And I think that we have to subscribe to that and be part of that, because for us it's very important to stay against Chinese unwanted or risky offers together with our partners.
James, do you still have any time in London to discuss China, or is it all Brexit?
No, there's been Brexit. Yes, but there has, I think, been a kind of rethinking that's beginning to go on in London in relation to China. Less so about Russia. As I said, I think Britain sees Russia as a threat, and it has even been described by one minister last year as a strategic enemy, and that's quite robust language. But I think the challenge that both Russia and China pose to us as a country, the UK, but also to the Euro-Atlantic system, is somewhat different. So for me, Russia is an anti-systemic threat. It simply seeks to degrade, negate, break down, and stoke discord among us, because that's the only way it can have any form of influence, because we have significantly more material power than Russia does. But China is a very different type of threat. It's a bit like the Soviet Union or Nazi Germany before it. And that's to say that it's a counter-systemic threat. It doesn't simply seek to break down and to degrade, it actually seeks to replace, to capture and to replace. So when we talk about, or when we discuss the idea of Belt and Road initiatives, or the expansion of China's economy. What we're actually talking about here is the expansion of a Chinese-centric world order and the replacement of our own. That's the replacement of our liberal values, our democratic structures, and our economic system. And I want to point out that I don't think we should necessarily be concerned about whether or not China and Russia merge together in some form of alliance, although, of course, that would be deeply dangerous, probably more dangerous for the Russians than for us in some respects, because the Chinese will become the dominant partner in that and the Russians will dance to China's tune. But I think it's, in some respects, this is an issue that we need to think about in much more detail, because it seems to me that one of the problems is that for the last 20 to 30 years, we've assumed and hoped that countries like Russia and then China would become so-called responsible stakeholders in our system. But it seems that actually that's not happening. As they're getting richer and more prosperous, or particularly in China's case, they haven't become responsible stakeholders. They haven't adopted liberal values. They haven't become more democratic. They've actually become more authoritarian, more autocratic, and more hegemonist in the way that they look at the world around them. And it seems to me that what we need to think about much more in much more depth is the connection between geopolitics and economics. Because for the past 20 to 30 years, we've tried to offshore our manufacturing industries and increasingly our more high-tech manufacturing industries, particularly to China, while it's simultaneously become more powerful and more authoritarian. And we still have the means, I think, to draw back from that and to, let's say, constrain China's rise, or at least to constrain it in ways that are more advantageous to our interests. And that is, I think, the big issue that we need to think about over the next 10 to 15 years, and probably the next 5 to 10 years to be more realistic. And that's why I think not only is there a rethinking of the neoliberal agenda within countries like the UK and the US, but this has to now take place on a wider level, and it needs to take on an international and an economic perspective. Because if we don't, then China will get stronger, it will get more powerful, and eventually it will turn against us because it has a very different idea about how societies should be organized. And it sees us, I think, as does Russia, as a threat, because our open, liberal, creative, dynamic societies are a threat to the very existence of the regimes that govern or even misgovern the likes of Russia and China. And they cannot allow our system, our way of life, to get inside their own countries, because of course their own people they then may start to demand the same rights and things that we enjoy here. And that would become an immediate and systemic threat to the regimes in those countries. So therefore, their objective is quite simple, to make the world safe for autocracy, to make the world safe for their autocracy. And that's, I would say, a direct challenge for us and everything that we believe in as liberals, as Democrats in Europe and of course in North America and elsewhere.
Well, British foreign policy establishment usually describes Russia as a threat or a challenge or a rival. China seems as well to be on the same lines. But on the other hand, we see that, for instance, Russian investment in London is enormous, and that goes with political influence or at least an economic influence to some extent. Isn't the story being repeated with China? Mm-hmm. You can talk on a political level by stating that China is a rival and etc., but on the other hand, you see it being embedded in the way of life in London or in other cities as well.
Yeah, I don't want to overemphasize that. I think it's a serious problem that we must come to terms with. And I think actually that in terms of China, it's much more profound than with Russia. Russia has been allowed to invest in, or Russians have been allowed to invest in infrastructure, in housing in London. But in the case of China, it's actually British and US investment that has gone to China, which has in turn helped to build up their manufacturing base, which in time has produced the resources and the capabilities that have then been used at the national level by China to improve China's position and the power of the regime that governs China. So that's the key thing that we now need to think about. The extent to which we are prepared to allow this system to continue. And that opens up lots of really awkward and complicated questions that run against the grain of everything we've told ourselves for the past 20 to 30 to 40 years. And that's something that we just haven't been prepared to think about because it's so difficult to come to terms with. But I think it's something that we are going to have to think more about and come to terms with if we want to prevent the rise of a Chinese-centric Asia and even a Chinese-centric world. Because they do have the potential,
the potential at least, to not only match us as a peer competitor, but also potentially to overwhelm us because of their geography, because of their size and their ability to draw together the attributes of their national power in a way that we seem unable to do or even unwilling to do, because we're not an authoritarian regime, nor is the United States, nor are many other Western countries. And that is something that we really, really need to get to grips with. I think it's beginning to change. People are beginning to think this through, but I don't think we're anywhere near where we need to be. And I just had a little caveat onto this because I think it's quite interesting and important, and that is the issue of climate change. Because a lot of discussion has been had in my country over the last few months, even the last year, about the fact that Britain is now producing less CO2 emissions and other greenhouse gas emissions than it did in 1880. So there's been a significant reduction over the last 20 years. That's wonderful. But there's a very simple reason why there's been this large reduction. And it's not because Britain or Britons are consuming less. It's simply that the emissions have been displaced. They've been displaced to countries like China. They've been displaced to countries like Indonesia and India, where the environmental standards are much lower and it's much easier to produce, to create pollution. So this draws us back to another angle that we need to think about in terms of the economics, the geopolitics, and the issue now increasingly of climate change, which has the potential to undermine us all.
Okay, I would like to switch a bit because it's still a Lithuanian Foreign Policy Conference, so we cannot neglect the elephant in the room, and that's Belarus, the most often named country during the presidential debates of this year. When the candidates spoke on foreign policy, they usually talked on Belarus because that seemed to be the major issue. So I would like to ask you three different questions from three different perspectives on the same country. While the question being asked from the audience focuses on how to warm up the relationship with Belarus from Lithuanian perspective. So Margarita, could you speak a bit on that? What practical steps could be taken, should they be taken from Lithuanian side in order to improve the relationship with the country with which we have the longest border and which is extremely important for geopolitical reasons, especially at the time when the ties with Russia seems to be increasing and there is a risk of losing Belarus as a separate political entity, even if it's a quasi one. General Spalding, we've seen a lot of American interest in Belarus recently. We've seen former National Security Advisor John Bolton traveling to Belarus. And it seems to be one of the countries standing in between not only the West and Russia, but also the West and China. And we have a lot of big projects planned in Belarus related to China. For instance, highways that should basically connect Belarus, meaning Europe, with almost the border of China. So what's the perception of this country in DC, and how are they important for the United States and China? And James, still, Eastern Partnership. Belarus is a part of Eastern Partnership policy. And while the UK will not be in the EU soon, supposedly, let's see how that goes, but supposedly, how interested will London be in countries such as Belarus? Not necessarily all Eastern Partnership 6, but maybe specifically Belarus and maybe a bit Ukraine when it leaves. What kind of actions Britain could take in order to maintain its role in the region? So maybe Margarita, could you start?
Thank you. Yeah, there is still a big ongoing discussion in Lithuania. So should we invest in the better relations, closer relations with Belarus? And what should we do? And then I can see here again two camps. One of the camps would say that, you know, Belarus is already lost and it's already captured by Russia, and whatever we do, it doesn't make sense. And at the end of the day, it takes two to tango. So if Belarus is not interested, we shouldn't do anything. And we've seen this again and again, that, you know, there is some time of openness from Belarus side, and then when there is a need from the finances from Russia, they are turning their back towards us. And there is another camp which would say that, okay, the things have been not probably very smooth ever since, but, you know, maybe we are facing some window of opportunity at the moment, because there are increasing pressures from Russia, that Belarus would be more integrated, and maybe we should help on the Belarus to withstand these pressures. So I would say I would be in the middle between two of the camps, and I would say, even though Belarus is lost and it's already a part of Russia, maybe it's still important to talk on the issues which are important for us, and there are a number of issues, starting with the economy. The business relations between Lithuania and Belarus are quite good, so maybe that could be a good start. But on the other hand, you know, with this, these two countries, these integration efforts, at some point remind me Potemkin village. I mean, there are lots of agreements, lots of institutions, but are they working? Will they work? I mean, all the facades, some kind of a facade showing that there is this integration. So I think that talking is a good thing, and we can start from the areas where we have already some interest, common interest is the economy, culture probably also. And then there was this attempt from the president's side to organize this common burial in Lithuania. So I think that it was good, and it was good for the Belarusian society, because what we've seen in the streets of Vilnius, lots of Belarusian flags, which I'm not sure if Belarusian televisions have showed these flags, but you know, it could be some sign and symbol that could have some inspiration for the Belarusian civil society. So it's good talking, but always having in mind that, you know, we had a very difficult history, and you know, it's always going backwards and forwards, and probably it's not going to be very smooth and direct road.
Yep. Dr. Spalding?
So I alluded to what I think is coming, which is a focus on investment, not just in the United States, but also abroad. We doubled essentially the size of the Overseas Investment Corporation. We're reinvigorating the Export-Import Bank. We're focusing and targeting USAID development aid. And so when you put all of the capability of the United States in terms of strategic investment, and you start to begin to look at the world differently in terms of how do we use these tools in much the same way that we used to use, then I think you can begin to create, in conjunction with our European allies and our Asian allies, a theory of how we should approach development. That not only promotes economic prosperity in the countries that are challenged for that, particularly of Central Asia, but also how does that, you know, also contribute to national security. So it is the case that infrastructure has quite frequently been used both from a military perspective but also an economic perspective. In the United States during the 50s, we had the Eisenhower Highway, National Highway System, that was connecting our Air Force bases. But it also has been the case that that highway system has driven great economic growth in the United States. And I think China has certainly looked at this and as a way to create an Eurasia that is centered on China. And I think we have been essentially absent in both thinking about and preparing for and then devoting the resources and political will toward countering in a way that is not to say, we can't say those countries don't need that kind of development. Of course they do. And what can we do as free nations to help not just drive economic prosperity, connectedness, but also do ways that promote institutions that continue or further democracy, human rights, civil liberties, and rule of law, but also provide for the national security of the nations of Europe and the United States. So I think this is where we have a lot of work to do in the United States, but we can't do it alone, and we're going to be looking to our allies to help us prioritize, strategize in terms of how best to do it. But I think if I was to look forward and say the next 20 years, what would the U.S. be known for? I'd rather be known for as a builder than a breaker. And I think over the last 20 years, we've been known for breaking things. I think in the next 20 years, we should be known for building things, and that should be done in ways that promote European security, but also European prosperity.
Thank you.
On the issue of the Eastern Partnership, I mean, if the UK is going to withdraw or leave the European Union, which seems at this moment in time likely, particularly if there is a Conservative majority in the general election tomorrow, I mean, I don't think the UK has a role to play there as such. But I do think the UK has a role to play either in supporting what the EU seeks to achieve in relation to Eastern Europe or the new Eastern Europe by the countries that are not part of NATO or the EU, or even it has a role to play in agitating for change. Now, the UK is one of the world's biggest givers of official development assistance. Last year, the UK gave something to the tune of 13 to 14 billion pounds. That's not a small amount of money. Now, if you add that up over the last decade, you end up with something between 80 and 100 billion pounds, which is a sizable amount of money. Now, is that money being used effectively? And some would say that it isn't. It's being used to alleviate poverty around the world, and that's all well and good. But is that necessarily corresponding or linking up with Britain's strategic interests? Because there's, of course, a connection between the two. We want countries like the UK to be as influential and powerful as possible because they have the ability to organise and to distribute resources to those that need them. So we don't want them to be undermined, ditto the United States, also some other European countries. So what we want to see, I think, is the UK playing a role, and I would use Boris Johnson's term here, as a kind of flying buttress to support the European Union in certain areas where it is doing good work, or to envisage it playing a role to supplement or even go beyond it. And I think it's becoming, as I said earlier, increasingly apparent in London that we are engaged in a political war with Russia. And therefore, we cannot simply sit back and wait for them to take the initiative. We have to take the initiative to them. And that means a much more antagonistic relationship, a competitive relationship, where we seek to shape, to change, to evolve the region in accordance with our interests and our wishes and our desires, and not theirs. So that means more support for Ukraine. It means more support for the countries of the Caucasus. And it means perhaps rethinking how we've done things in relation to Belarus. And there are ways that this could be achieved. Firstly, through the desecuritization of our national approach. And I think more broadly, the approach of NATO and the European Union. The rethinking of the way in which we give official development assistance to benefit those countries which we think are of strategic importance to us in not just the short term, but also the longer term. That means a fundamental rethinking of the way in which that's done, including the definition of ODA. And I think it means a refocused and reconcentrated effort in areas of concern, i.e. those spaces, Ukraine, the countries of the Caucasus that are not members of NATO and not members of the EU, that are open to Russian and I think increasingly, as time goes on, Chinese interference. And that just requires a complete fundamental change in the way that we think. We cannot simply sit back and wait to respond because we've lost the initiative. We have to be on the initiative. We have to think about what we want and what the countries in the region themselves want, and we have to push that hard, even if it ruffles feathers in Moscow.
Do we have anyone who would like to ask a question by using a microphone instead of the website platform? The sun is shining, but I don't see any hands. Okay, so let's stick to the platform because there are a lot of questions still to be answered. Another group of issues that are to be discussed probably on this panel are related to NATO. NATO summit took place just recently in London, and there were a lot of emotions because of the arguments made by President Macron saying that NATO's brains are supposedly dead because of multiple allies doubting Article 5 and its implementation in practice if it's necessary. We have a lot of discussions still on defense investments and maybe alternatives to all of it. So the question is probably, first of all, related to Macron and France. Is it a country that can really propose an alternative security engagement? Margherita, you mentioned a bit the aspect of strategic autonomy. Autonomy, as Macron stated in his interview, not only from Russia, but also from the United States, at least on defensive matters. So is there a way of being safe and secure, especially in our region, without being in NATO? is NATO on a brink of collapse, or is it just an overemphasis on the emotions of politicians rather than on practice on the ground, which seems to be not too bad, at least in our region, but also beyond? And third, what's the role of the United States still? Does the US want to disengage from Europe because it needs to refocus to Indo-Pacific region, because it needs to refocus on China? And still, even the biggest world superpower, it has limited resources to combine all those priorities together. So maybe let's start with James now. What do you think on these issues?
On the issue of NATO and brain death, and also those in other capitals that have questioned the willingness of either the US or the UK to underpin the defense of Europe, I think these are deeply emotional and even dangerous statements, and those that are making them should basically pipe down. And this is connected to the idea of France as some kind of replacement or supplement to the deterrent that is provided by the US and the UK. And the issue here is quite complicated, but basically boils down to a fundamental aspect, and that is that the two countries, Britain and the US of course much more, but Britain also, have spread out their conventional capability across much of the length and breadth of Europe. So the US has countless military bases in other European countries. It has countless troop deployments, large numbers of troops, and large numbers of civilians in those bases, women and children supporting and living with those troops. The UK has a broad distribution of military bases around Europe, whether that's in Germany, and the bases in Germany will remain, Gibraltar, Cyprus, troop deployments through the enhanced forward presence, Norway, Iceland, Romania through the various Baltic and Black Sea policing and North Atlantic policing efforts. The two countries have an extremely expansive distribution of their conventional forces. Now, it's all very well to say, as France or Mr. Macron might, we stand to deter threats to European security. We will put our nuclear deterrent forward, and if anyone challenges the cohesion of a NATO or an EU state, we will respond. But without that forward deployment of conventional forces, I think that's largely just a bluff. And I think the Russians will understand that. I mean, the question has always been raised, will Britain or will the US trade potentially a city in Eastern Europe or Central Europe during the Cold War for London, New York, you know, Chicago, Los Angeles, Manchester, whatever. But it was only through the extension of their conventional forces, actual living bodies on the ground from Britain, from the US, that that deterrent was actualized. Because in the event of a hostility or confrontation, British or American troops would probably get killed. And that would immediately call or lead to calls in London and elsewhere in the US for a response, because, well, naturally British and Americans have been killed. We want revenge. And that creates that moves everyone up the escalatory ladder, and everyone knows that. So those troops that have been forwardly deployed are often called tripwires, but I think they're more like cobwebs, because if an enemy were to advance into the cobweb would stick them and they would get increasingly stuck, and it would make it more likely that the spider would activate and come out and, you know, stab them with its fangs, and therefore they would die. So the issue is much more complicated, and I think in that context, France is unwilling and unable to do what Britain, or more importantly, the US, has been willing to do for the past, 70 years. And this is a deeply embedded idea in both London and in Washington. And to challenge it or to question it is, I think, deeply destabilizing and dangerous. And therefore, I'm not worried, even with the possibility of the changes in the UK tomorrow, or with some of the things that Mr. Trump has said in the United States, that this in the longer term is going to be challenged. Because there's no other country in Europe that can provide the kinds of capabilities that either of those two countries can provide.
Dr. Spalding?
Well, I think clearly NATO is still relevant, and it's relevant in two ways. It continues to be required to deter military conflict, and it's also required. It needs to change, though. It does need to change to confront the different ways that particularly the Russians and the Chinese are using cyber as a means to undermine our societies. And traditionally, NATO has been very much focused on military power. And I think one of the things that it needs to do is adjust to the 21st century digital world and become much more capable in the cyber realm. So I don't see the United States, walking away from NATO anytime soon. A strong, healthy, free Europe is clearly in the interest of a strong, healthy, free United States. The way we keep Europe strong, healthy, and free is a NATO that deters, a military conflict, but at the same time actually deals with the threats of today. So, it's unfortunate that the United States has been mischaracterized as wanting to leave NATO or wanting to abandon NATO. I think, quite frankly, those narratives are promoted by the Russians and the Chinese, who would like to see the relationship broken up and really would benefit from that. And so, it's just for us to continue to renew, strengthen NATO in the ways that it needs to be for the 21st century.
But you also said yourself that the U.S. military is refocusing on other regions, not necessarily Europe anymore. And that probably means less engagement, at least in practice, not necessarily leaving the institutions themselves. Does that weaken NATO, or you can combine those two priorities?
Well, I mean, one of the things that both the Russians and the Chinese have done have relied very much on intermediate range ballistic and cruise missiles, conventional intermediate range ballistic and cruise missiles. And this is a challenge that we, quite frankly, because we were a signatory to the INF Treaty and obeyed it, as opposed to the Russians, have put ourselves in really a difficult position, because those weapons are quite cheap to manufacture, quite cheap to deploy, and quite hard to find or kill. And using our current capabilities, even with the modern technology of today, is still a very difficult weapon to go after. The way you counter mobile, conventional intermediate range ballistic and cruise missiles is with light capabilities. And so we need the ability to actually deploy those types of weapons, certainly in the Indo-Pacific theater. And of course, it remains for Europe to decide how to deal with the Russians. But clearly, we cannot have a force that takes 10 to 20 times the expenditure to counter what essentially the Chinese and Russians are doing.
Dr. Shishilgita?
Mm-hmm. Well, strategic autonomy is, I would say, quite French concept, and it refers to the French direction that France took after the Second World War to develop strategic autonomy to defend themselves on their own. So therefore, it's not necessarily a negative concept, not in French context. But in order to ensure strategic autonomy, it took some years for France. And in general, if you understand about the development of capabilities, so you understand that it's a long, lengthy process, 20 to 30 years. So if we want to talk about the strategic autonomy, we have to persistently invest into this goal for 20 or 30 years. It will take time. So now, today, to talk about the strategic autonomy, it would be not very fair, I would say. And in order to have a strategic autonomy, you have to political will and finances to invest into the development of capabilities. I can see that it's being born now in Europe. There is more political will, at least on the European level, and there are some additional finances, but it will take some time. One of the challenges is diverging threat assessments. Again, when you say that you want to have strategic autonomy, first of all, you have to ask the question, from what? Okay, that's probably the US, and to do what? So if you're talking about protecting Europe ability to protect Europe against the migration flows. Probably the EU already has some certain strategic autonomy to do this on its own. But if you are talking about the full-fledged conventional warfare, including the use of the nuclear element, then the answer is no. We do not have strategic autonomy. So we have to view this discussion in this perspective. We have probably strategic autonomy to do some tasks, but not all the tasks which are necessary for the defense of Europe. And if we want to achieve this, we have to have political will and have finances to do this, but that will take a long, long time. So the better choice would be probably to have cooperation between the EU and NATO. And that was a problematic question due to the political problem involving Turkey for a long, long time. In 2006, there was sort of a NATO rapprochement on the highest political level, but also on the lower level, there are some cooperation initiatives, declaration on joint activities. And what I'm looking from purely academic perspective, that would be the most efficient way to go. NATO is focusing more on the conventional side, and the EU focusing on the hybrid threats, addressing the hybrid threats or low-intensity operations, low-intensity crisis. Because EU, in its essence, has a wonderful toolkit to address hybrid threats, economy, politics, communication responses, all these necessary responses might come from the European Union. So as an academic, I envision that the cooperation between two would be the most effective. But the problem, again, different diverging threat assessments on one hand. On the other hand, political issue is still not solved. And now we saw that this political issue from the EU-NATO format had jumped into the NATO problem. So at some point, this issue has to be dealt with.
Can I just come back in on one issue? Because I didn't really get to that issue, and that is, what do we do, or what do Europeans do, if and as, I would say, as the United States becomes increasingly involved in the geopolitical situation in the Indo-Pacific region in relation to the rise of China? And I think, you know, these discussions about European autonomy are in many respects, just distractions. They're being put forward by people who wish to hide the fact that they are themselves naked. Because, as you said, if you want to have European autonomy, you've got to invest a significant amount of money for many, many years in order to get there. And countries like France, Germany, some others, I'm sorry, they're just not even at the 2% mark yet. And the idea that you can do that on those kinds of defense budgets, it's simply not enough. The 2%, which we've become increasingly mesmerized with, remember, was initially put forward, I think, in 2006 as the lowest amount of spending required to maintain existing capabilities and to reorient our military so that they could undertake some degree of expeditionary warfare. This is not sufficient for the kind of world that we now seem to be moving into, which is a world structured by intense geopolitical and state-based competition that is being engaged across the plethora of different levers of power. So if we want to maintain the defense of Europe as the United States becomes increasingly involved in the Indo-Pacific, and that's to say that's not necessarily saying that that's also not European security, because what China does in the Indo-Pacific is going to have an impact on us in the Middle East or in the Mediterranean or even in the Baltic, let alone, as we were talking earlier, about the potential relationships between Beijing and Moscow. So what we actually need is for those European countries that are still not spending or meeting their commitments to actually step up and reach them and to invest significantly in their conventional capabilities so that they can intersect with what the British and the Americans can provide at sea and at the strategic levels and reinforce what countries in this part of the world can provide in relation to defending their own homelands, so that we can make sure that the levels between here and London and Washington and the activation and potentially of the nuclear capabilities, that there is actually sufficient linkage between the two, because that seems to me where we are lacking. We lack the mass to push towards the frontier to underpin the deterrent that is already available. And until those European countries step up and actually engage in Plan B, and Plan B is actually increasing defence spending and the efficiency of defence spending to get the relevant capabilities, we will be going round and round and round in circles, and the distractions will continue to deflect us from the actual problem, which we identified earlier, that is to say, the threat from Russia, the challenge from China, and the emergence of great power competition.
Before we move to the concluding part, just a little bit on the country that was not mentioned directly here, even though it's very important, that's Germany. So while we talk about France, we seem to be not speaking at all on Germany anymore because of multiple reasons probably. Germany's role has been decreasing a bit, at least in recent years, due to internal issues and some other aspects, and the leadership of Macron, at least on the rhetorical side. So would you like to add up a bit on what you've said by looking specifically on Germany, because its role has increased actually in recent years, at least in our region. We have enhanced forward presence led by German soldiers, and it was a very significant step by the German foreign policy makers to do it, to send troops to the Eastern European country, especially knowing how Russia reacts to these kind of aspects. We also see that Germany is very supportive of sanctions on Russia while the situation in Ukraine doesn't change. On the other hand, obviously, the United States focuses on the aspect of Germany not spending enough on defense and maybe being a reluctant leader of Europe in terms of doing more in geopolitical situations. So any one of you would like to add on this by focusing on Germany? Just a couple of sentences. We had to have a German representative here. Unfortunately, he couldn't come due to unforeseen circumstances, but still.
Well, I mean, from my UK standpoint, I would say I would like to see Germany meeting the commitment that it made in 2014 to spend 2% of its GDP on defence and 20% of that 2% on the modernisation of its armed forces, and to do so over a sustained period of time. I simply do not buy the argument that it would take too long to reach that by 2031, and I do not buy the argument that it is too difficult financially, because if Estonia and if Latvia and Lithuania and Romania can all do it, all countries which have a significantly lower gross domestic product per annum than does Germany, then Germany can also do it. And I think it is imperative on countries like the US and the UK and the Baltic states and Poland to impress on Germany how important it is to reach those targets, and to do so as quickly as possible. And the idea also that, you know, it would be problematic if Germany spends 2% of its GDP on defence, because it would have potentially the second biggest defence budget in NATO, even bigger than the UK's. It also doesn't wash, because in the late 1980s, Germany had for a very short period of time the second biggest defence budget in NATO, even slightly larger than Britain's and France's. So these kinds of arguments, they have no water. So I think it's important that Germany meets its commitments, so that we can move on and underpin the defence of our own continent.
Yeah.
I would say that, you know, I would not limit German significance or the significance of the role of Germany to the defense issues. 2%, I guess it's important, and they are going step by step towards them. But, you know, you have to understand circumstances. Why for some years Germany has been reluctant to invest into the defense, and you know, when you have to jump from 1.2% or 1.1% to 2%, having in mind the size of German economy plus the fact that it is growing, it's a bit, you know, too complicated even to imagine this. So I believe in 2%. I strongly believe if you say 2%, then you have to do this. Either you don't talk about that, but you know, you have to understand the context. But I can see that, you know, the role of Germany in Europe has been growing, not probably for the last year, due, as you very well mentioned, internal affairs, but the role of Germany is particularly important for the Europe. I think French and German leadership is very important for the future of Europe, and I believe that it's going to go that way after the internal issues probably would be settled. And it is important on one hand because they have the leadership, their biggest countries on one hand. On the other hand, their approach towards the future of Europe, towards the reforms, is in a way different. And it reflects differences in European Union. So it is very important to have two approaches. And therefore, I think that at least in this part of the region would be more need for the German leadership in Europe. So I could say that, you know, I see Germany as a potential European leader, and it's not necessarily, it cannot be limited to the defense issues. Yeah, so I think that's...
Yep.
Dr. Spalding? No, I agree with that. I think clearly you could say that Germany's had their cake and they've eaten it too. They've not contributed to fully to NATO. At the same time, they want sanctions on Russia, but at the same time, they're pursuing things like Nord Stream 2. And then you have, of course, the enormous trading relationship with China. And so, for Europe to be secure, I think Germany needs to kind of make a decision in terms of what's important to it. In terms of national security, and then, you know, how it fits into ensuring that all of Europe continues to be strong, prosperous, and free.
So let's move to the conclusions, and I would ask all of you to maybe name three biggest challenges for the Western community in the upcoming decade, if you could. But I'll not let you off the hook that easily. Please include some remarks on Turkey in when you talk about these challenges, because obviously those who have been to London or followed NATO summit in London know that Turkey was the big issue, not least because of the Baltic defense plans, but also because of situation in Syria, because of weaponry from Russia, and because of still being an essentially important ally for NATO in a very important geostrategic region. So, three biggest challenges in your perspective for the upcoming decade and Turkey. Dr. Spalding, maybe?
So, I think number one is preventing a conflict, major conflict. I think that is something that we need to focus on, and quite frankly, we should be very, very secure about how we're deterring that. I think the other two go hand in hand, and that is economic prosperity and science and technology. I think we need to promote the economic growth of democracies, and I think we need to promote the science and technology capability of democracies. And I think we should caution against allowing the benefits of open societies, innovation, capital, technology, and talent to flow into authoritarian regimes. So I think we need to focus on assuring that those growths accrue to nations that are more closely aligned with democratic principles, human rights, civil liberties, and rule of law. And to the extent that other nations don't want to participate in those kinds of principles or values, then they should have less and less connection to that growth and development. Ultimately, what we're looking for is to create societies that are that provide for their citizens and that encourages and promotes the idea that democracies really have the kind of society that people want to live in.
Yeah.
I would say that, you know, in the forthcoming years, the main goal of this part of the world, of the West, would be to, as I already said, number of times today, to protect our Western way of life, and we are facing several challenges in doing so. So first of all, increased global competition, powers like China and Russia and others, also terrorists. But so another challenge would be to build necessary capabilities and resilience to withstand these challenges. And that's not an easy task. It's also about the political commitment, finances, etc., etc. And above all, staying united, because I think that's one of the biggest challenges, which could spoil other efforts, even we are successful with the other efforts, this could be a spoiler. So, what to do in order to stay united? So, first of all, be open, talk about our different attitudes towards threats and other things, political interests, but don't forget the values. Values that we have, we share those values. And we also have to be more open with our partners and internally probably what values we stand for. And here comes the question about Turkey. Do we still share the same values? And we need the answers.
Question mark.
James. Maybe I could rephrase a little bit or something along that line. Lord Ismay, who of course is thought to have produced the sort of founding ethos or the founding direction of NATO, which of course was to keep the Russians out, the Germans down and the Americans in, or something along those lines. I'm paraphrasing it. So I think our role as we move ahead is to keep the autocrats out. And I think we might need to start reviewing to some extent the nature of the regimes of some of our own members within NATO. Maybe that answers the question in relation to Turkey. You cannot have a country in NATO that does not share the worldview of the rest of the alliance, irrespective of how important it is strategically. So we need to find a way of getting over those two issues or a way around those two issues. I think we need to keep the sovereignists or the European sovereignists and the Shirkas down, because they're actually a threat from within the broader Euro-Atlantic framework as well. And I think we still need to have a way of keeping the Americans and the British in. And I say that as the geopolitical environment that we now live in is radically and increasingly different to that of, you know, the late 1940s. So the autocrats out, the sovereignists and the Shirkas down, and the UK and the US in. And I think if we can manage to do that, we'll be in a very solid spot as we move ahead over the next 70 years.
Well, Chancellor Konrad Adenauer once said that every part of human body gets tired except the tongue. So we could continue our conversation probably for hours and hours. But let's stick to the program and let's go to the coffee break. A big round of applause for the speakers of this panel. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Gotcha. And we have some presents for the speakers.